hope he sticks to the record. You know?
Yeah.
Curiosity.
It looks like, Amelia, looks like that live button is we're live.
We're live.
Well, I'll tell you what. We're going to go live. You guys ready to roll?
Yes.
Let's do the show. It's 4 o'clock in Los Angeles. It's 6 o'clock in Chicago, 7 p.m. in New York City, and it's 7 a.m. somewhere in deep Australia. Hello, everybody. I'm Mad Dog DeCipio, joined as I am each and every week by the Pitbull, Amelia, the Pitbull Chapman. How are you, Amelia?
Good. How are you?
I'm wonderful. What did you do this weekend?
Oh, just enjoyed my weekend and enjoyed some time with the kiddos.
You had a good Mother's Day?
Yes, I did.
Fabulous. I'm going to start off this show tonight with an announcement. We have a major coup. Yeah. June 16th, television and film actor Johnny Whitaker. You remember him from Family Affair. He played Jody, the little boy, with Buffy and Sissy and Mr. French and Uncle Bill. You know them guys, Brian Keith, Sebastian Cabot, and the rest of the crew of Family Affair. Well, Johnny Whitaker will be with us for the entire show on June 16th. That's a Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern. Join us for that one. And I have a very special guest coming in July. You're going to look twice when you see him, too. He is a dead ringer for Howard Stern. My friend, Stuart Brolin, will be with us. And tonight, talk about doing double takes. Well, let me tell you a little bit about our guest. Our guest tonight is Marcus Cahill. Now, Marcus is a singer-songwriter. He is an accomplished award-winning performer. His Imagine tribute to John Lennon has garnered worldwide praise and attention, so much so that Marcus holds the record for the most performances ever by any artist. Listen to this one, because it's not a small task. He has garnered a world record for his portrayal of John Lennon having performed at the famous Cavern Club almost 500 times.
Wow.
And that's a real number. You can check the actual number. I believe, Marcus, it was 469 maybe, or somewhere around there.
Well, it was debatable. We had quite a few people checking in on that one. They had to go through all the books and check when I was actually working. I wasn't aware this was going on until later. But, apparently they've agreed that 436 shows that they can find.
Yeah.
But I think it's possibly even over 500, to be honest, because
somebody suggested that it may be over 500. Let me tell you.
Yeah.
We have a connection here on this show to the Cavern Club. Debbie Greenberg, who was a friend of mine, used to own the Cavern Club.
Yeah. Hi, Debbie.
Yeah. Debbie's a good friend of mine. She's a guest on the show, and, she's got quite a history with the original Cavern Club.
That's true.
And it was actually, she's actually quite responsible for the new place that was built.
Very much so. Her and her dad, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Sure. Absolutely. Yeah. Her father's the unsung hero here. He really is.
Yeah.
But let's talk a little bit about Marcus Cahill. I want to introduce everybody officially. This is Marcus Cahill. He is the world's foremost, and I mean that in every literal sense of the word. He is the world's foremost John Lennon tribute artist. He is also in his own right an accomplished singer, songwriter, and musician, winning awards wherever he has gone, and he has performed worldwide, ladies and gentlemen. So would you please welcome to the show, Mr. Marcus Cahill. How are you, Marcus?
Welcome to the show.
I have to tell you, my friend, you look like John, you sound like John, and it's remarkable that even now with a little bit of gray sprouted out on that handsome little face of yours, you still look like John and you still sound like John.
Yeah. I was trying to do a Ringo show.
Oh, you were going to do a Ringo. Now you have to watch now. Because Ringo dyes his stuff. He colors that shit.
Good. I think Ringo looks fabulous, man. He keeps up to date. He looks like he's still 18, mate. He never grew up.
You know, did you hear the rumor about this? You know, you can't have, for some reason, Marcus, and I don't know whether it's just the Beatles or what, but whenever you mention the Beatles, there's always a conspiracy theory swirling around it. And the conspiracy theory here is, and I can't make this shit up, I promise you. The conspiracy theory is that Ringo was the one replaced, not Paul. Because Ringo is older than Paul by 3 years.
I'm not very good with the dates.
And Ringo runs circles around people. Because he just doesn't stop on stage. He's always moving.
Yeah, he's fantastic. Honestly, I wish I could see him play drums a bit more. But that's me. I want to see him doing what he's good at.
Yeah, but you know, and a part of the problem is though that he is 83 years old, there's only so much. You know, I mean, when he was younger, he could bang the sticks pretty good.
Yeah,
not so much anymore. He like plays the keyboards a lot now.
Does he? Yeah.
Yeah.
He's got about two songs on that one, hasn't he?
Yeah. Absolutely. I'll tell you what. You know what? You guys, you want to talk about the Beatles a little bit? Let's talk about the Beatles. Because I could talk about the Beatles all night long.
Right,
it's fair to say that you're probably around my age.
So you're about 45?
I got 20 years on that, brother.
Yeah. I've got about maybe 8.
Yeah, I'm 64 come July. So I might have a few years on you. I don't know. But you and
I'm only 52.
Oh, okay. So you're just a young pup.
Yeah.
You're Amelia's age.
There you go.
Yeah. So I'm let's in good talk company. About this.
Yes.
Let's talk about the Beatles. You're a lifelong fan. When did the Beatles music grab your hold of your soul? When did it grab you by the seat of your pants? Obviously, it still got a hold of you.
Yeah, pretty bad. Look behind me here. You know, this is John. All around the rest of the room is the Beatles and Paul. And they're all here.
Oh, God. So, sure.
Yeah. So this is actually where we do this. This is an Astrid one. This is taken by Astrid.
Oh, all right.
The photographer that the Beatles knew. We'll get to all that. My father's a guitar player, singer-songwriter, and he was a massive Beatles fan. And, of course, passed it on to me. I used to get little songs at the end of my bed when I was told to go to sleep. So I'm like 2-3 years old, and I'm convinced my father's in the Beatles.
Right?
Yeah, I know. Well, he knows all the songs. The conspiracy,
right?
It's a conspiracy, but I was already there. It was just magical. He made it like a bedtime story, you know. So I had Bungalow Bill, and I thought, oh, Bungalow Bill, that's really funny. You know, Yellow Submarine, all of this escapism, you know, Lucy in the Sky. And I'm getting brainwashed at the age of, 2-3 years old to listen to this.
Oh, yeah, sure. Absolutely.
So it's really Dad's fault, to be honest. But lucky for me, he's actually a well-accomplished guitar player. So what he was playing was what was on the records.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that made life a lot easier because I've already heard it.
Absolutely. So when did you start to follow in your dad's footsteps playing the guitar? And
right.
Well, Dad had the guitar, I didn't, and so I had to steal Dad's guitar when Dad was at work. And, of course, Dad had placed the guitar in such a way that he knew that I stole the guitar. So,
absolutely.
But, yeah, it's funny we should talk about that guitar. I used to play it when I was about 4 or 5 years old, about five, we'll say. And it's only recent that the guitar we originally had, my dad's guitar, we've lost it because we've left Ireland and moved to Australia. The guitar's gone. Nobody knows what happened. And I've always felt that was the guitar that would come to me. You know what I mean?
Sure.
As I got older. So anyway, I seen one, funny enough, on Facebook, and I bought it.
So, oh, wow.
It's not the guitar, but it's the same guitar, if you know what I mean.
Everybody who knows me knows I want a guitar.
Yes.
Now, I'm going
to get one.
I'm look, if I got to go to the Goodwill and buy one, I'm going to go
get it. Yeah, do it.
Well, the birthday fairy might get you one for your birthday.
My birthday there you go. Anybody watching the show out there, by the way, my birthday is July 10th. a black guitar, acoustic guitar would be wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
It would be even more wonderful if it had electric pickup, but that's not necessary.
Somebody might have it saved to the
Lucille written on the top.
Exactly, right?
Yeah.
Somebody might have it saved to their Amazon.
You're right, right, Amelia? Let's talk a little bit about the music bug. Clearly, the Beatle bug bit you when you were a very young guy. At what point in your young life did you start to appreciate the diversity of music around you?
Oh, now that's a funny question, because as I said, Dad was a very accomplished guitar player. So he was playing everything from Paul Simon to all of the standard 60s hits. Mm-hmm. He was good. Dad was performing, you know, so
yeah.
All my life, I grew up watching Dad in bands and stuff. He was a folk and ballad singer guy.
Well, I'm going to ask you, Marcus, was your father part of that 1950s doo-wop era of music?
No. He was born in 1950, so he was more into the 60s stuff, where it was skiffle onwards.
Okay, so gotcha.
Literally, he was already into the music by the age of 12, so that would have been about 1962. Which is perfect because the Beatles came out, Lonnie Donegan, all of that early 60s stuff. So he was very much influenced by all of that.
Yeah. So your father he's young.
Yeah.
He was a young guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
He was younger than the Beatles.
Yeah, well, that didn't take much.
No.
That didn't take much. Were you aware at the time that before the Beatles there were the Quarrymen and the Silver Beatles? Were you introduced to that kind of music?
Not at the start. No, not at the start. That came later with a lot of research.
Oh, gotcha.
What I had when I was growing up was I had Dad's records.
Oh, gotcha. Mm-hmm. Terrific.
Yeah. And then when everybody in the family realized, oh, he's going to be the next guitarist, so wonderful, they started dumping all of their records and the 45s on me.
Yeah.
So I had one of my uncles gave me all his Shadows and Cliff Richard.
Yeah.
But I love the Shadows. Hank Marvin is one of my guitar heroes from an early age because of that exact thing. So I've actually met Hank years later and told him.
Embarrassingly.
Wow. Oh, mate.
Wow.
I could drop names all night here, honestly.
Oh, yeah. You know what? Between the two of us, we could.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. One of the people who I absolutely love actually is an Australian. His name is Andy Lee Lang.
Okay.
I don't know if you know who he is.
No,
it's funny because he came here. It's funny how things work. Andy Lee Lang is a native Australian. He's from like New South Wales. Mm-hmm. He came here to the States and just busted on the scene like wildfire, just crazy stuff, right?
Right.
And he's selling millions and millions of records. But he can't get arrested in Australia. The same thing with people here. They can't get arrested here, but they go to other countries and they become millionaires overnight. It's just crazy. Well, I want to talk to you about that because you went through a bit of this.
I did.
That you actually, you're from Australia.
No, from Ireland originally.
Oh, well, but you spent a whole lot of time in Australia and where you still are.
Yeah.
And so, I'll throw in the Irish part too. In Ireland, England, that area, the Northern European area, particularly England and Ireland, in that, in the Scottish Isles up there, it's hard to break out of that region and become, you know, universally famous. The fact that the Beatles did it in Liverpool, of all places, was a shock to the system. Because before the Beatles, the biggest thing you had there, and you know where I'm going to go with this, the biggest thing you had there was Rory Storm and the Hurricanes with a drummer named Ringo Starr.
Yeah.
And that's the biggest you had there. They had to get out of Liverpool to make it big.
That's right.
Why is it that people don't appreciate the local talent is what I'm getting at? Because you experienced that.
You're so right. Yeah, you're so right. It's crazy. It's like the Beatles came back from Hamburg and everybody thought they were German.
Exactly. you know, it's funny because Debbie Greenberg and I had that conversation. We had that conversation. Yeah, she said that they came back. Everybody thought they were a German band. Then realized that they were from Liverpool.
That's right.
That was crazy.
It's funny you should mention Rory. If I'm not mistaken, and I'm not sure which of the boys did it, whether it was John or Paul or Ringo, whoever, but they used to bring back German biscuits, I believe, for Rory's mum.
That was Ringo.
Was it Ringo?
Yeah, Ringo used to bring back biscuits for Rory's mum.
Yeah, there you go.
Because Ringo's mum liked the biscuits too, so he used to bring them back for her as well.
Yeah,
Ringo's mother was his biggest fan. You know that?
Yeah.
Everywhere Ringo's mom went, she took a sock with pennies in it. British pennies. The woman grew up very poor, very humble, and she never, even when he was making millions of dollars, she could never let that sock go. She always had pennies in that sock. Funny story about Ringo. Let's talk, Amelia.
Yes.
Let's ask questions of our friend, Marcus Cahill.
Yes, I was
just... gentle.
No, I was just wondering, you know, when you were growing up and everything, what was the first song that you learned to play on your dad's guitar?
Oh, okay. Well, you're not going to believe this, but my first song to attempt to play was actually from Band on the Run. I'm going to get dates and years all messed up here now because I'm forgetting more than I've learned, if you know what I mean. It was a song called Let Me Roll It. And I just liked the song. And so it was my life's mission to learn how to play it. And of course, it wasn't a simple song to learn at 5 years old. So then Dad got tired of listening to me. Repeat. I'm still trying to. I'm not giving up. I'm going to get it. Leave me alone. Yeah, I'm in there like 6-7 hours trying to play the same song. So my family, thank you very much for listening and putting up with it all. It's been 50 odd years of it now. So, but that was it. So Dad kind of figured, look, I better show you some stuff. So he showed me how to do rock and roll. And that was it. It just went from there.
Those are the best.
Is Dad still around?
That mom and Dad are still here. Dad's
God bless
still playing,
you.
And I'm still chasing his tail. He plays. Have you ever heard of Chet Atkins?
Yes.
Oh God, sure.
Yes.
So Chet Atkins, Tommy Emmanuel. Mm-hmm. Dad's kind of at that level.
Wow. That's a pretty damn good level, brother. I got news for you.
It's huge, especially when you put it into the Beatles.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, the people don't realize this, but Chet Atkins, I have a friend. I want to try and get him on the show tonight, too. I have a friend that was the first person in the United States to hear Paul McCartney and Wings, because they became Paul McCartney and Wings at Junior's Farm in Tennessee.
Right.
Yeah. Well, my friend Dan Ely is the guy that met McCartney and gave him a bass guitar. I'm going to see if I can get... You know what?
Man, I know this story. Yes. I think I know this story.
Do you know the story?
I think so. Dan
Ely's a very, very dear friend. He gave the...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he gave Paul a Rickenbacker bass.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Yeah, and that's... I'll tell you what, man. That bass made the rounds. It sure the hell did.
I think so. Didn't he end up getting it back?
Yes.
Yeah.
He did.
Paul gave it back. And that's where the story starts.
Yeah.
That's where the story starts, because it took a 42-year journey back to Dan.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Oh, incredible. My God. I'm going to send you... Amelia, remind me. I'm going to send Marcus that show.
Oh, absolutely. That's a fun
I'm going to right now. I'm going to see if I can get Dan on the show.
Yeah, that was interesting.
I'll tell you what, folks. I'm going to pull out of here. Amelia,
yes.
You and Marcus have a great conversation.
Okay, sounds great. Right.
Ciao.
He'll be back.
It's just me and you now.
Yes, absolutely. I was also looking at your bio. You were said that you'd rather be a sound-alike than a look-alike. But what?
Very much so. That was a big one for me. I didn't like the whole dress up, put on the wigs, and I just didn't want to take it that far. It was already bad enough being obsessive, but then to be obsessive compulsive with an addiction, I just didn't want to go that far. I mean, everybody was on my back. That, oh, you've got to do it. You have to go. Oh, my God, you so look like him. And then, I put on the hat and, oh, you look more like him. And I'm thinking, I didn't see it. Honestly, I really didn't see it. But I had to learn how to move like him then. And because what's the point in getting dressed up if you don't do the moves?
Exactly.
So I already had all of the footage, all of the albums, all of the bootlegs, everything. I'd studied and listened to so much. It was just, I had to have it all. Oh. I couldn't just like listen to one little song or the standard hits that everybody has. I took it to the extreme. I wanted to hear every concert, every mistake, every blooper, you name it. I wanted it. And so I incorporated all of that into my performance. So right. Then when the fans came in to watch, it was like an overflow of all of the stuff that they thought, oh, he'll probably do one of them. But they weren't expecting all of it. And so that's what blew them away, I think, the most. It wasn't so much that I looked like them. For most of my performances, I was just dressed normal. It was only when I did the big shows that I started wearing the hat and the wigs and the jackets and all of this rubbish. But, yeah, it wasn't something I was into, but I did it because they wanted it, and I just wanted to see them all smiling.
Wow. Was it a stressful thing for you to do, like, night after night? Did it ever get to you some nights?
I had to wash it so many times. You have no idea. I used to sweat in this thing every day, and I'd have to wash it, dry it, press it, get it all ready for tomorrow. Come on.
Well, we are going to be joined tonight by Dan Ely very shortly, Marcus.
Hey. Oh, well done.
Fantastic. Did you ever put in some of your songs that you ever wrote yourself into the shows as well?
Well, funny enough, now things started off where my intention was to just purely be a John show, because that's where I was aiming at, and hence I'm dressed in a 1974, 72, I think it's a 72 costume, possibly 71, I don't know. So anyway, I'm wearing the army thing, so somebody will all correct us now. They'll be like, it's 71, it's 72. I think it's 71. I seem to recall I'm wearing it at one of his concerts. One to one was 71, I'm pretty sure. Anyway, where was I going with this question?
If you had put in some of your songs that you had written.
Oh, my mother
has that effect on everybody.
No, I just got sidetracked trying to figure out the dates. That's why I've got to stay away from dates. I'm really bad with it. Birthdays, the whole lot. I'm shocking. But no, I did get to do it in the Cavern. I was playing mostly John, and then people were complaining that he's not doing enough Beatles. And then they started complaining, he's not doing enough George or Paul or Ringo. He's not doing this. And I said, listen, I'm not the Beatles. I'm just a guy that's trying to do a John Lennon show. Yeah. How can I be the Beatles? It's just one guy.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you're just one.
No, they weren't having it. Everybody wanted what they wanted, and that was that. So I was given the all clear to be everyone and anyone. And so the way I accomplished it was by taking the mic or having a bit of fun at their expense, if you know what I mean.
Right.
Oh, sure. So, absolutely.
Yeah. I was just having fun with it. I'm in there every day. I was going, yes. Woohoo. Yeah, man. I was there. It's like Beatle world all day, every day. Yeah, you know, right. You want to talk about the Beatles? Oh, cool. I'll talk to you about the Beatles for 10 hours. So anyway, I got to play a few of my songs toward the end of my stay at the Cavern. They sort of like, yeah, go on, do one of yours.
I went, oh cool. Okay.
It was nice to be asked. So I played a couple of, and they were all like, wow, he's actually good. Oh, wow, you're surprised? Okay. But yeah.
Marcus, let's take a look. I want to take a look at some of your earlier stuff from the Cavern Club. We're going to do something we call show and tell.
My favorite.
Let's take a look at this. Yeah, exactly, right?
Yes.
Here you go. Let everybody take a look at Marcus Cahill.
Here we go.
Hey, old boy. About a lucky man who made the grades.
That's just chasing my dream. I had enough of not getting my dream, which was to basically play in front of Beatles fans and travel the world. And just, you know, I love the music. I love the fact that it celebrates peace, love, you know, good things, kindness, fun, energetic. It's just everything that I wanted to say. And I couldn't say that in some Irish group or whatever. I couldn't say it. My heart was always trying to say it via the Beatles. Because it made sense to me.
I'm so glad that she's my little girl. She's so glad she's 7 months old. Got a baby by the veins, you know. By the tamarines, you know. She said so. She's in love with me and I feel bad.
Live at the Cavern Club. Joining us, ladies and gentlemen, is a legend in Tennessee, particularly around the Nashville area.
Ooh.
Hi, Mr. Ely.
His name is Dan Ely. He is a good friend of mine.
Hi, Mr. Ely.
He is the guy famous worldwide for the guy that met Paul McCartney and handed him a rather interesting gift. A 1974 Rickenbacker bass. Marcus Cahill, meet Mr. Dan Ely.
Thanks for that, Angelo. Hey. Nice.
And there's the bass. That bass has quite a legacy, quite a story.
By the way,
Dan, I mentioned your name to Marcus, and he knew the name and he knew the story. Now he gets the chance to see the guy behind the story. So Marcus,
nice to meet you, Dan.
Nice to meet you. Thank you,
Dan. Yeah. Marcus is the world's foremost John Lennon tribute artist, as you can clearly tell. I told him a little bit about this. I didn't want to ruin the story for you. So, tell Marcus a little bit about that legacy, that guitar's legacy.
Well, for some reason, when I went down to the farm to try to find Paul, I took my guitar.
As you do.
I'm not sure that I went through any thought process with it, but I took it. And when I got out at the farm with the bass, Denny Lane was there, and he strapped it on.
Check it out.
We all have a connection with it.
And he said, "Hey, Paul would love this." And I said, "Well, give it to him."
Really?
I hadn't had it very long. It was new, and I bought it from Manny's music shop in New York. And I left the bass with Denny to give to Paul. And I mean, I went down again for about 3 weeks, and it wasn't till on Paul's birthday on June 18th of 74 that I heard anything about the bass again. And that was when, miraculously, I had been recruited by Jimmy McCullough to work security at the gate. I had no idea that there was any event going on. I wasn't even supposed to be there that day, but I showed up and I noticed some activity, champagne coming in, a little flurry buzzing around. And I said, "What's going on?" And he said, "We're having a little get together down at the picnic area, a little party. Paul wants us to work the gate, but we don't want to, but you can do it." And I said, "What's work the gate?" He said, "You know, you'll be at the entrance and you'll let people in that should be in and keep anyone else out." And I said, "Well, how will I know?"
"You'll know."
He said, "You'll know. It's going to be Chet Atkins, Jerry Reed, and Roy Orbison. And if you'll do this for us, we'll take you down to meet Paul." So I said, I'm in. And I headed out for the entrance. And about 400 foot from the entrance was a little picnic pavilion by the pond. And that's where Paul and Wings was gathering with Linda and for Paul's birthday party, his 32nd birthday party. And in a minute, a Porsche came down the road and turned in. And I looked inside the car, and it was Roy Orbison. And he had all black leather on, leather pants, black leather jacket, black t-shirt. And it was 98 degrees that day. And I was waving him in, and I looked inside the car to watch him go by. And I thought, man, it's too hot for leather. But then I thought, hey, it's more important to look cool than be cool.
Don't forget, that's Roy Orbison. He was cool. And that was Roy Orbison, and he was cool.
So I was watching the event from about 400 feet away, and I had thought, based on what Jimmy told me, that one of the guys in the band would at some point leave the party and come and get me. That was my concept of the way this was going to work. In a little bit, I noticed someone walking away from the party through the field, and I sort of got on my heels to look, and it was Paul. And he was wearing the shirt I had given him days before, this embroidered shirt with birds with Paul embroidered on the collar. And he was walking alone through the field toward me. And I was trying not to panic. In fact, I reached in my pocket and I grabbed my camera foolishly and I put it up on the gatepost. Like Paul was going to detect that I had the camera in my pocket or something. And he comes up to me and he says, "You're the one with the bass." I said, "Yes." And he said, "You know, it would be silly for me to keep it." And he and I walked together back down to the party. And the first thing he did was say, "I want you to meet Roy Orbison." And I shook hands with Roy. And by that time, the only ones at the party was me, Paul and Linda, Roy Orbison, and the guys in Wings. And it was a very low-key party, just a background music from a radio or a cassette tape and a little bit of food and the night air in Tennessee in late June. And I remember that Linda had like a peasant dress on, long down to her ankles. It had flowers on it. I think I've identified it in a picture I've seen on the internet as the one she had on that night. And Denny had his arm around her waist on one side, and Paul had his arm around her waist on the other side, and they were just sort of enjoying the moment. And yeah, I was the only one there with them. Now, later on, I had moved away from Paul to sort of give him some room, and Jimmy hollered at me and said, "Dan, Paul's hollering for you." And I turned around, and he was in the rental car that was pulled down by the pavilion, and Linda was in the car, and he had rolled down the window, and he was waiting to tell me goodbye. I mean, it just tells you the kind of guy he was. He yeah. wanted to say goodbye.
Dan, do you have that photograph handy?
What, which photo?
The one of you and Paul next to the car.
I don't have a photograph of that because no. I left my camera.
Oh, well, wait a minute. There is a photo of Paul in the car with you yeah. next to it.
Yes, that
yeah.
one.
Show Marcus that photo for me, please. Mm-hmm. And by the way, we all have a connection to Denny Lane. We all know Denny.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Marcus works with him. He's a friend of his. You know, Dan does business with him. And I worked a show with Denny in 1987.
Way back.
Well, I told Paul at the car, I said, "Hey, Paul, you know Yellow Submarine is going to be on TV tonight. Are you going to watch it?" Mm-hmm. "It's on Nashville TV." And he said, "Well, I don't know. But here is a black and white photo of me."
Yep, mm-hmm. That's the one.
Uh-huh.
With Paul and Linda. There's a color one, but that's my black and white mm-hmm. one. But I yeah. It highlights Linda a little bit more. She mm-hmm. was sort of in the shadow. Here's one, the color one.
Mm-hmm. That's the one.
Wow.
But later I found out, I mean, you have to understand this bass journey took mm-hmm. some crazy trips, and I was standing in the field boy. With it at the farm one day, wrapped around my neck, and I thought, mm-hmm. I'm going to ask Paul to sign my bass. Mm-hmm. And I was looking at it, mm-hmm. trying to think, where will I have him sign it? And I thought I could have him sign it here on the pick guard. And then suddenly I thought, hey,
no,
he's a I don't want him messing up my bass.
Mm-hmm.
And so I flipped it over and I thought, okay, I could have him sign it here.
Yeah.
And he would have signed it for me in a heartbeat, but I never asked him to do it. And in the end, it was a fortunate thing that I did not ask Paul to sign the bass, because I ended up coming back after this lifetime experience where I came back and told all of my friends I just met Beethoven.
Dan, let me surprise you with something. And Marcus, take a look at this. There you go. How's that, Marcus?
That's my life. Very cool. Before my eyes.
Well, I'll tell you, Dan. I want to thank you, Dan, for joining us. If it's okay with you, Marcus, what I'd like to do, because I'm real good at putting people together, mm-hmm. I'd like to hook you and Dan up, because I'm sure there's between the two of you, between Dan's ability to tell the story. And all the damn stories you got, Marcus. There's enough for another show, because I want to bring both you guys back.
Yeah.
But, Dan, thank you so much for taking your time out of your busy day to join us.
Yeah.
I appreciate that so much.
It's my pleasure.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank
Before
you so
you
much.
Go, Dan,
you know, when I hear Junior's Farm, it's hard to explain the emotions with that, because I flash back to standing outside the house, listening to them play this song I'd never heard before. I was hearing Jet, Band on the Run, My Love, Little Woman Love, Maybe I'm Amazed. And it's all I can do to contain myself. And then I hear some song, I don't know what it is. And believe me, I know all the McCartney songs, all of them, the most obscure ones. And I asked Denny when he came out, Denny, what was that song you kept playing over and over? And Denny just said, you'll find out later. And it was October of 74 that I heard it for the first time on WLS Chicago, debuted by John Records Landecker, and I pulled the car over off the road to listen to it, because I knew that was the song that I had heard and that I had recorded on my cassette recorder standing in the field in June. Hey, it's all out there. They all know.
Oh, God, yeah.
I recorded the song before Paul did, and I heard the song before anyone else. So how can that song could play 24/7 at my house and I'd never grow tired of it. In fact, I think I'll put it on tonight.
There you go. Well, Dan, thank you so much for joining us. I'm gonna let you go.
Okay.
Well, I owe you.
Thank you, Marcus.
Thank you.
Great to see you, Dan.
Here, my friend.
You too, man.
That was awesome, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a great guy. Mm-hmm. He is a great, great guy. I'll tell you what, when you talk about music legacy, that's the kind of stories that I'm sure you have similar stories, and we're going to get to some of them. Yes. But before we do, we have a happy little sponsor that loves when we play their commercials.
Yeah.
So let's take a listen to this. Sit back and enjoy a word from our sponsor at Shopify.
Jess wanted to start a business when something surprising happened.
Today, I'm going to teach you how to crochet.
She started crocheting, like a lot, and her friends noticed.
Jess, you need to sell those.
So, she signed up for Shopify. and started building her business.
Yes, I love that.
And after a lot of hard work, this happened.
Oh my gosh, I just made my first sale!
You see, every day, hundreds of businesses get their first sale on Shopify.
We got dang!
And the next could be you. So when you're ready to bring your idea to life
and become your own boss,
build it on Shopify.
Do you have sweaty balls or volleyball netty balls? It's time to make them ready balls. The Manscaped.com Lawnmower 3.0 will do the job and clean your knob with its patented no-nick head, so your head will function as desired. Enter promo code WrestlingFuture for a generous 20% discount. That's enter WrestlingFuture for a 20% discount. Manscaped.com and Wrestling with the Future, going balls to the walls with Manscaped.com and the Lawnmower 3.0, your balls will thank you, and so will we. What's Buzz Podcast wants to welcome Radioactive FM 88.6 in Wellington, New Zealand, Radio Perth, Australia, and RTL Radio 102.5 in Milan, Italy. Welcome aboard, and welcome to the Buzz. Welcome back, everybody. It's Marcus Cahill. He is our special guest tonight. And we are back with more questions for Marcus. Let's talk a little bit about, here you go. I wanted to get into this one with you. Let us talk a little bit about the art of performing someone else's music. Is there extra pressure on you that there doesn't exist if you're performing as Marcus Cahill rather than performing as John Lennon or another personality? What's the pressure like as compared to performing under your own music?
Criticism.
Ah.
That's it right there. Criticism. Yeah. People have something to say when you're performing as Elvis or Tom Jones or whoever it is you're performing as. He's not really as good, is he? No. Mm. But he'll do. It's all we've got, you know? But there's a lot of people like myself included. I'm one of them people. If I see another tribute guy or Beatle band, I'm sorry, guys, but I'm being criticizing too. I'm in there just keeping my, yeah, you're wonderful. Yeah, but deep inside I'm going, fuck, you know, I'm not going to watch that again.
Yeah. my wife and I, Marcus, my wife and I recently, very recently, in fact, had a chance to see a band called the Fab Four.
Fabulous.
Yeah, they're incredible. The gentleman that plays the John Lennon part in that show, his name is Ron McNeil.
Good friend of mine.
Oh, you know Ronnie, okay.
Oh, I know all the boys. We played together. Yeah.
Oh, you did? Okay. Let's talk a little bit about that. The Fab Four, those guys are, you know, they are remarkable.
They are.
Everybody from, Artie Saraf, Ron McNeil. The fellow that plays George, I forgot his name. He's actually from Liverpool.
Gavin Pring. Thank you.
Yeah. He's actually from Liverpool.
And Lolo on drums.
Yeah, exactly. It's remarkable though that to your point, people have something to say about everybody unless they're at that certain level that's, I call it the unimpeachable level, that they can't, nobody can say anything bad. For example, we have a guy here in the States. His name is Bill Cherry. He's probably the closest thing to Elvis Presley you'll ever see. We have Ron McNeil. We have Artie Saraf, the Fab Four, who are unimpeachable. They're probably the best four Beatles guys on planet Earth. You running a very close second in the John department. Actually, I'm going to correct myself. In the John department, you stand alone because you don't do anyone else. All you do is John. And that's unimpeachable because nobody can touch your look. Nobody can touch your vocal ability. You look like John and you sound like him. Even talking to you tonight, your speaking voice, I feel like I'm talking to John because I know what his voice sounds like. Here's the question I have for you.
Yeah, you'll pick up on that.
here's the question I have for you. On a spiritual level, because Amelia and I know where we're going with this. On a spiritual level, do you feel like to some extent you're channeling John on a spirit level?
I never, ever, not me personally, no. I never took it into the creepy zone. For me, like I was saying earlier, I didn't like the idea of dressing up with the wigs and the costumes and the guitars and everything has to be authentic. I just wanted to perform the songs as me. And that's what I felt I was doing. I felt like I was doing that in the Cavern for the first half of the career. But then after a while, the T-shirts start coming in and New York City and, yay, you look like John. There's actually some guys out there that look insanely like John, but they haven't got the talent to back it up. And that's the sad part. Yeah. So that's the sad part. But there's some really great lookalikes. But
they're remarkable.
Brother, I never wanted to be one.
There are remarkable, absolutely remarkable lookalikes. But again, putting the money where the mouth is. That's once you open your mouth, something has to come out.
Yeah.
Squeak.
You know?
That's what it sounds to me. Because, like, I've heard so many guys do this, and I'm going to get into trouble for saying this, but I don't care anymore. A lot of guys think that John sounds nasally. And so they have this interpretation. Mm-hmm. No? Yeah,
I never thought that.
You don't know never thought guys that. Singing you like that.
Yeah, I never found John to be nasally to me.
No, not John, the tribute guys.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. They've all got this interpretation that he's got this. How you doing? He's got this kind of, imagine there's no heaven. And I'm like, he doesn't have that. He's got a broad spectrum.
At all. Yeah. Now, where did they get that from?
I don't understand
that at all. I don't understand where they get that. There's nothing upper nasally here about John at all.
If you listen to him speak,
his speaking voice is actually on the lower end. Marcus, let's take a look at a piece of.
Yeah,
absolutely. Marcus, I want to take a look at a piece of film. Let's all take a look at this together.
Okay.
People say I'm crazy, doing what I'm doing. Well, they give me all kinds of warnings to save me from ruin. When I say that I'm okay, well, they look at me kind of strange. Surely you're not happy now, you no longer play the game. People say I'm lazy, my life away. Well, they give me all kinds of advice designed to enlighten me. When I tell them that I'm doing fine, watching shadows on the wall, don't you miss the big time, boy, you're no longer on the ball. Watching the wheels go round and round, I really love to watch them roll.
asking questions, lost in confusion. Well, I tell them there's no problem, only solutions. Well, they shake their heads and they look at me as if I've lost my mind. I tell them there's no hurry, I'm just sitting here doing time. I'm just sitting here watching the wheels go round and round. I really love to watch them roll. No longer riding on the it go. I just have to let it go. I just have to let it go.
There you have it, folks. John's car.
I love it. By the way, that was performed by Marcus Cahill. How did you come to be with John's yellow, iconic yellow Rolls Royce?
Well, that was around the time that I was getting ripped off by my third or fourth manager.
Oh, Jesus.
We were in. Yeah. Yeah, there's lots of reasons to go back.
An old story in the entertainment business.
Oh, I tell you. It's a constant one, to be honest.
Yes.
The car was in Canada somewhere. No, I don't know where. I literally just hopped in and out of cars and hotels. I don't remember where I was half the time. But it was in Canada somewhere and some museum, Perrier or something. I can't remember. But, it was great. They, as you've seen, wheeled in the car and whatnot. And it was just cool to see the real one because there's been many a discussion with many the person saying, oh, I've seen John's car. And as soon as they show me the picture, I know that they haven't because I know the difference between the cars.
Yeah, yeah.
And they've got
there
the paint
are,
job.
We should tell people, Marcus.
The car.
Yeah, Marcus, we should tell people that there are a couple of look-alike cars out there.
That's right.
And they all purport to, yeah, they all purport to be John's yellow Rolls Royce. Well, the, yeah,
this is supposedly. The one.
The one that you just saw on this video is the actual yellow Rolls Royce.
That's the real one.
And there are very distinguishing identifying marks on it if you know what you're looking for.
Correct.
And I know what I was looking for, and I saw it.
Cool.
Amelia, questions from Marcus Cahill.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I
go for it, kiddo.
Yeah, and you were saying that, you know, you went through managers and things like that. So when did you start representing yourself after a while without the managers?
You know what? I was getting nowhere representing myself because like most musicians, I'm a musician, not a manager. Hence, they always went in and got really shit record deals and bad contracts and God knows what. We wear our hearts on our sleeves, musicians.
Yep.
We're here to share stories and passions, not preach, if that makes any sense.
Yes,
but,
absolutely.
Yeah, there's a little line and some of us jump over and some of us don't. I got a couple of managers together figuring, you know, maybe they should know better and they can do it better. And
yeah,
it cost some money. And then we went off to make the money. And then I came home with no money.
It happened to the Beatles too, Marcus.
Yeah,
it happened to the Beatles too. And then we're talking about, you know, millions of pounds, millions of dollars.
We are.
A lot of money. You know,
it's a lot of money.
People like, you know, Alan Klein, Brian, of course, before, you know, Alan, Brian Epstein, of course.
But Brian was
a lot of money. Yo, God, yeah. A lot of money on left a lot of money on the table. Definitely. Let's talk a little bit about the financial aspect of what you do. And you're absolutely right. Musicians want to sing. They want to tell their stories. They want to spread the love through music. All very admirable. But at some point, the rubber does hit the road and reality does hit us in the face.
Yeah.
And we have to deal with the financial aspect of it. Has it been worth it for you? Whether you made tons of money or whether you made no money, has it been worth it for you to perform?
Yes. Yes. It has been worth it. The money would have been a bonus. But the thing that I got from it was the enjoyment. You got to remember, I'm hanging out with other addicts. I'm in a room full of addicts. We all love the Beatles.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I say one little thing, and I've got a room clapping.
Can I tell you something?
It was crazy.
I will tell you something. I used to perform. I no longer perform. This is my method of performance these days. I performed stand-up comedy. I was a professional MC, television and radio. And that's what I did. And I also sang a little bit. And as a child into my teens and young man, I played the drums. Ringo, by the way, Ringo was my inspiration. Now turning 64, I want to learn how to play the guitar. But I will tell you, though, that Amelia and I can absolutely relate to what you're saying.
Yes.
Because we don't make a dime from this show.
We do not.
No.
Neither do we pay anybody because we don't have a budget. Nor do we ask anyone out there for money. I have
You'll be hearing from my manager.
Yeah. And we have sponsors on this show who don't give us money. Here's what they do. They promote our show for us. And you can't put a dollar figure on that. I am going to put you on the spot, my friend. I'm going to ask you to sing a song for us.
Oh, okay. You got one in mind?
The one you sang to me on Facebook. One of my favorite John songs.
I didn't sing to you.
It's called Dear Yoko.
Oh, you want Yoko? I could have brought the harmonica. I haven't got the harmonica with me this time.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, there you go. You're asking.
I'll tell you what, then. You perform whatever you want to perform.
Oh, okay. How about I just take you on a little journey? How long have I got?
You've got about 15 minutes.
15? I can feel that easy.
Okay, well then you got 20 minutes.
I'll do a little edumacation. I'll show you some of the things that I like and why I like
them. A medley.
Well, I'll tell you what, why don't we do let's do a medley. We'll do this is Marcus Cahill and mini concert.
Yes.
A mini concert, all right. I'm just gonna talk to you guys. Feel free to chime in at any time. But here's a little something, for example, with yesterday. All my troubles seem so, yeah. Okay, so we all know that song. That's it in F. But really, as far as I can tell by listening to it, I think he actually plays it in G. But he's tuned the guitar down to F. So he would have sounded a bit more like this. The original version, when he played it, it would have been more like this. Yeah, a bit higher. Yeah, different now. Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. It's really high. Yeah,
wow.
So that's why he plays it in yesterday. Yeah. So there you go, two different yesterdays.
Absolutely.
What else have we got? I know, a lot of crazy stuff. We got, for example, we've got I've forgotten half of this stuff, man. It's about 15 years since I played it. Yeah.
Got some to
imagine.
Strawberry fields.
I love that song.
So Strawberry Fields is out of tune on the record. Why? Because they speed the tape up so it sounded a little brighter and better. It was higher.
Well, you know, a lot of people, let's talk about, that's a really good point. People don't understand that it actually is slowed down. What do you think about the experimentation that George Martin used to do? He used to play around a lot. Inevitably, well, here's a serious question. Inevitably, yeah. Was it a good thing or a bad thing? Did it help or hurt the music?
Definitely in your opinion. Definitely helped, but I'm going to add a little spice to that meal, if you don't mind. And
sure.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but Jeff Emmerich, whom I had the pleasure of working with, Jeff was the guy with the hands on the desk.
Yeah.
George was sitting in the background with the ideas and discussing what they could or should do. How about you do a little bit more of this and a little bit of less of that, Jeff? And Jeff would be in there tweaking it. Can you change the mic position, Jeff? Jeff would be in doing the mic positioning.
Mm-hmm.
All to get different frequencies, different volumes, different sounds.
Yeah.
Create a new this, create a new that. So all of that fancy recreation stuff, I'm going to say, is more Jeff than it is George. A lot of the books say it's George, but I don't think George was, as a producer, he would come up and say, we should put a little string section. But he wasn't in there miking them up.
and I think you're absolutely right. And let me add to that. I believe that as a producer, probably none better. But as a technician, certainly lacking, in spades lacking. Jeff was the guy for sure. Absolutely no question.
There was a guy George, before him. I can't remember his name, though.
George had the ability to foresee things. I put it this way. George Martin had the ability to see what the music would look like.
Yeah.
Jeff had the ability.
Were all doing that.
Yeah. And Jeff could hear it. He knew what George could see. Jeff could hear what George could see. If that makes sense.
Yeah. And George was seeing it because the other four were telling him to see it.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep. Well, I mean,
that sound like the Dalai Lama on a hill, you know?
Well, so, I mean, the truth is, you know, these four guys have to perform that stuff.
They never did a lot of it, actually, which is funny, because when you consider it, they finished performing, 1966? So all the psychedelic, really crazy out there stuff with the orchestras and all that.
Yeah.
Mostly later.
Yeah. Oh, sure.
You know, so all the earlier stuff was just a band. And that was the beautiful part about the Beatles. As a band, they were way more technical and advanced than what they played.
Yeah.
So they were downplaying it, if you know what I mean. So
you
had Mozart playing Mary Had a Little Lamb, basically.
The style difference, much has been made of the style in music between 61 and 64, and then the dramatic reversal, or I should say the tailspin, that happened in 65 with Revolver, 66, 67 with Sgt. Pepper and Abbey Road to follow. There was a dramatic shift. You went from "I want to hold your hand" to "It was 20 years ago today." You know, I mean,
yeah,
big. You know, that's a hell of a gap to fill.
What do you think
musically the Beatles were going through between 64 and 66?
A whole bunch of drugs.
Well, yeah, it didn't help. Yeah.
I'm sorry to say it as it is, but that's pretty much what it was.
It sure was. I can't argue with that, Marcus.
No, they were experimenting at that time. that was the Bob Dylan era back in the 64, where right, John wanted to be Bob Dylan, and of course he got to meet his idol. No little pun there, Paul. And then Paul got to meet his idol, Elvis. There's another little pun, Paul. So a lot of people meeting their idols. What do you say, Paul?
Yeah, right.
So it's funny, actually. If you give me a second, I'll give you a really good giggle. Hang on. I was at a concert for Paul, and I was holding this sign up.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. And I kept on flashing this to him all the way through the concert, the poor guy. And, of course, nothing happened. A good friend of mine printed it up. He said, I've got it for you. I said, oh, great, cool. I was up in the second row. So, he's seen
it. That's funny because Dan Ely that was on the show tonight, Dan went to a Paul concert, and he had a big sign that says, I met you at Junior's Farm.
Oh.
Paul called him out from the stage.
Oh, nice.
He did.
He did connect with me at that concert because I was, I'm flipping this thing all the way through hours. Trying not to get it in everybody's view, of course. But,
How much at the time did you look like John? Did it catch his attention?
I look like this. This is what I look like. And I was just standing there like, come on, give us a go. Let me up. Whatever you want to play. It doesn't even have to be Beatles. Just anything. I've always wanted, as since I was a little kid. And so my thing at the time as a little kid was I was going to join the Beatles. And this is before John and George left. This is before the boys were all passing away. I was joining the Beatles.
Yeah.
So I've got to do a lot of practice. I got to be really good because I'm going to join the Beatles.
Yeah, exactly, right?
Yeah.
Well,
it never
happens. I will give you your audition right now. Play Strawberry Fields for me. Let me hear that one.
Oh, let's try that little riff again, eh? So. Oh, that's not it. Oh, I've forgotten it all now. You should have learned it. Anyway, let's go. Let me take you down, cause I'm going to Strawberry Fields. Nothing is real. Nothing to get hung about. Strawberry Fields forever.
Yay!
You got that. Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Beautiful. Oh, that is amazing. Fabulous.
Getting back to that song, Amelia, that you were asking earlier, what was the first song? It was this one.
Gave me
love. 50 years it took me to learn that.
That's beautiful. I can see that's a lot of guitar lyrics on that.
But I was mad into it. So I was listening to that album and I was getting all the.
Oh, yes. Beautiful.
Come on, Paul. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Panned on the run.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Panned on the run. Yeah.
Gonna give it all away. Charity. All I need is a pound today. If I ever get out of here, if I ever get out of here.
That's beautiful.
I wanted to do this.
Beautiful.
Marcus, thank you. Let me play. I want to do another show and tell, Amelia. This is our last show and tell of the night.
Oh, yeah.
Marcus, take a look at this show and tell here, my friend.
now, that last photo.
Wow.
Yep. Yep.
Ooh, yeah, yeah.
Never get
interesting,
to see that one.
Interesting. The very last photo in that show and tell slideshow there was John signing an autograph for a man that would eventually just moments later shoot him. Mark David Chapman. Let's talk about, and I put that photo in there purposely. Let's talk about the fine line between fandom and fanaticism. I know impersonators who have absolutely fanatical followers to the point where they think that the person they're following is the original. I'll give you a perfect example of what I'm talking about. I know a person, I won't say who they are, but I know this person believes that Doug Church, who's an Elvis tribute artist here in America, that Doug Church is like Elvis. She thinks that he's Elvis. Okay?
Yeah.
And he's one of 100,000 impersonators. You know, at least that many. But she's like, this person is like fanatical about this person. I've seen other individuals go just apeshit crazy over tribute artists like they're the real thing.
Yeah.
Have you ever found yourself in that interesting and creepy world of the groupie, the follower, the fanatic?
Oh, yeah, very much so. Very much so. I've had some creepy ones.
Can you share with us?
Yeah. Well, let's deal with the creepy one for start.
Uh-oh.
I was doing a show in the Cavern, as you know, for quite some time.
Yes, sir.
And I had this 6-foot gorilla with a big, long trench coat rocked up. And the coat reminded me of that last photo you just shown. And anyway, I come off the stage and I'm saying hello to everybody. And they're, oh, you're great. Thanks for doing my song. Yeah, no worries. I'm trying to make my way to the bar to get a drink of water. And by the time I get to the bar, I meet this big 6-foot gorilla. And he goes, who do you think you are?
Oh.
Hey? And this is the beginning of it. You know you're not him. I says, no, I know I'm not him. I'm just the guy on stage, man. What you know, you enjoying yourself? Uh-huh. And he goes, and that uncomfortable silence, and he just got closer and closer, and he got right up in my face,
and he says,
you're not him. And I was freaking out. I thought, oh, this is it. He's going to hit me. What's going to happen? This is crazy.
Oh, no.
I was already getting, oh man, I was getting death threats from emails. I was getting death threats and in general. I had people
saying,
such a buddy. I never figured it out until after it was all over. And I'm looking back in hindsight, it was, I don't know, jealousy for some of them because I was the guy that was becoming the king of the Cavern. Unwillingly, I was just doing a job, you know, paying bills.
Well, yeah, sure.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, it was weird, man. I had lots of really odd stuff going on, but it really sort of wore thin on my nervous system after a while because I started getting a little bit paranoid, thinking someone is going to try and pop me. Someone's going to do something. So I used to move really quickly. I used to walk as fast as I could, be always around. And I said it to the Cavern, and I said, listen, I'm getting really twitchy. This is starting to freak me out a bit.
Yeah.
I'm getting threats. And they, oh, yeah, sure. You know, you think it's gone to your head, Marcus. You know, relax, mate. And I said, no, guys, I'm serious. There's something wrong.
Yeah.
And then it wasn't just the male people that got creepy. I had this creepy girl from, I think, Czechoslovakia or Russia, one or the other, but she didn't speak. And she'd hide in the corners in the shadows so that I wouldn't see her in the archways. And it was like, I can see everybody in this place, you know.
Yeah.
I'm there every day. I know where to look. But I could see her. And she'd go from that corner over to this corner, and it would be just so creepy. And then she'd wait outside for me. And she goes,
whoa.
Yeah. And she gave me the look, and she's still not talking. And I said, listen, I've got to go. And she says, you want me to come with you? I said, no, I've got to go home.
Do you want me to come with you?
The show's over. I'm going home. I'm coming. No, you're not coming with me. No.
Oh, my God.
She got really upset. She was pissed off that I didn't allow her to come with me, so much so that she started to get more threatening. So she would send emails saying, roses are red, violets are blue, I think you're wonderful, and so do you, and all this stuff. It was crazy. God. None of it made any sense, and it was getting more, it was getting darker and darker.
That's very bizarre.
Oh, wow.
It was so
it's
creepy.
It's a strange line between, it really is a very, very strange line, a very thin line that you walk. Mm-hmm. Between fandom and fanaticism, you know, let's be honest, we have fans on this show, but we got a couple of fanatics too that are like out of their mind. Amelia, and you know, we used to do a professional wrestling show years ago, and we had some real creepy people with that. I mean, trust me when I tell you. Amelia, please tell me if I'm lying, please.
No, he is telling the truth.
Please tell me if I'm like even making this up.
No, you're telling the truth. I remember.
Marcus, not at all, I promise you.
Yeah.
Just bizarre, bizarre people. We have somebody in our chat room tonight. Hey, Mad Dog, big fan. When are you continuing the Mandela Matrix? Next week.
Yeah,
we are doing the Mandela Matrix next week. We will continue that. That's for Iron Claw 30. Thank you for being a part of the show. Be with us next week, Iron Claw. We are going to dig down the rabbit hole of the Matrix and Mandela. We got a 12-week series coming up, and we're going to expose the fake Joe Biden. We believe the president of this country is a poser. We think he's a fake. In fact, we think he's an actor, and we believe we can prove it.
He's wearing a mask.
Yeah. Wait a minute. I showed the video on our show.
Yeah.
Of Joe Biden wearing a mask.
He doesn't look like the same guy.
Yeah. Not the same guy. Yeah. The whole world knows that they're being duped. The whole fucking world. The whole world knows they're being duped.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm not an American. Forgive me for counting in on it, but I think he's an embarrassment, to say the least.
He's a
probably
horrible
embarrassment.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, we got breaking news, Amelia. Breaking news. This just in from the news desk, Joe Biden is still a moron. Film at 11.
Always been.
I thought they took us off the air. I thought, oh no, they're taking us off the air. They've caught us already.
No. It's the people that voted for him. That's it. Their fault.
Yeah, I'm telling you. Well,
but did they vote? That's the question. Did they vote?
No, they didn't vote. Nope, that was a rigged election.
Pelosi owns the Dominion, doesn't she, with the husband?
Oh, well, wait.
The voting machines.
Well, we're
Pelosi's got a little sticky finger in there, hasn't she?
Oh, yeah, she does.
You, probably.
Quite a few, yeah, actually. I'll tell you what, Marcus, you are an amazing guest. Thank you so much for waking up early in the morning.
Thank you so much.
I'm going back to bed now.
There you go.
We kept him up long enough.
By the way, ladies and gentlemen, Marcus is in Australia. It is probably about 8:30 in the morning where he is. He woke up at 7 a.m. for us. And no, in fact,
no, that's half five actually.
Yeah, he was on the air at 7 a.m. with us.
That's right. Yeah.
And it's probably pushing about 8:30 a.m. Marcus, I'll tell you what, brother. you are a welcome guest here anytime, yes, whether you want to sing for us
or come on
and talk about world politics. Yes. We'll bring you on. Oh, absolutely. Tell everybody where they can reach you if you want to promote your social media.
I'm everywhere. Just type in my name. I'm all over the internet.
It's Marcus Cahill.
Oops, Marcus Cahill. I guess he got out of there, but go ahead. Finish
it. Marcus Cahill on the internet. Type it into whatever search engine you use in the future.
And I just booted myself out.
I think my battery's gonna die soon. You know?
Oh no!
Disappear too.
I booted myself out. Well, I'll tell you what. For Marcus Cahill, for Amelia, the Pitbull Chapman, I am the Mad Dog, Angelo, Mad Dog DeCipio. Until we see you again, be kind to each other. Take care, and God bless everybody.
Peace and love.
Peace and love,
everybody.
Bye-bye, folks.
Bye.